If we were to look over the whole world, to find out the country most richly endowed with all the wealth, power and beauty that nature can bestow, in some parts the very paradise on earth, I should point to India. Thus wrote Max Müller, the German Sanskrit scholar. Ancient and medieval India did have a highly developed industrial base. Indian silks and muslins, handicrafts and spices were highly prized exports to Europe and the Middle East. The excellence of her products and rich natural resources attracted European adventurers to India. In 1615, the Mughal Emperor Jahangir gave a farman to the East India Company to establish a factory at Surat to trade with India. The business of the East India Company prospered. With the excuse of guarding their trading posts, the company raised large army units and embarked on territorial expansion. By the middle of the 18th century, the Company of Traders had become a military power. Gullible Indian rulers were bribed and encouraged to fight against one another. In 1757, Robert Clive promoted treason and treachery and won the Battle of Plassey even before it began. After the battle, when he entered Murshidabad city, he was amazed by the affluence and the prosperity. He described the city to be as populous and rich as the city of London, with the difference that there are individuals in Murshidabad possessing infinitely larger property than anyone in London. All that wealth was plundered during British rule, and what remained were only the shadows of a glorious past. The dark shadows of British rule lengthened to cover nearly three-fifths of India, subjugating the entire people physically, economically, and militarily. The once sound economic structure of India was deliberately disintegrated to serve British interests. According to Jawaharlal Nehru, the liquidation of the artisan classes led to unemployment on a prodigious scale. Even Lord Bentinck, the British Governor General of India, admitted, "The misery hardly finds a parallel in the history of commerce. The bones of the cotton weavers are bleaching the plains of India." The discontent of the masses led to an armed revolution, the First War of Independence in 1857. The British suppressed the uprising with the help of many selfish Indian rulers and other interests. In 1858, the administration of India was transferred to the British Crown. It was a strange situation for a country of 100 million people being ruled by a country of 10 million living some 9,000 kilometers away. The British built roads, railways, and telegraphic networks to link their military outposts in different parts of India to help British commercial interests. With the destruction of her industries, India had been reduced to a mere supplier of raw materials to British industries and to feed the industrial revolution in England. In the face of opposition from the rulers, Indian entrepreneurs put up cotton mills in Bombay, Ahmedabad and Nagpur. The British imposed heavy excise duty on Indian products and at the same time, customs duty on imports of Lancashire textiles was reduced to help the British sell their cloth at competitive prices. Because of unfair competition, Indian industry lagged behind. In 1874, to help Indian industry, Gopal Hari Deshmukh asked the people of India to use only Indian manufactured articles. Bholanath Chandra published a comprehensive plan for the boycott of foreign goods. He demanded the formation of independent Indian banks, Indian companies, mills and factories. He appealed to the Indian press to propagate the use of Swadeshi. In 1879, Dayanand Saraswati asked his followers to boycott British goods. J.C. Ghosh arranged to send 400 educated young men abroad for training in science and technology so that on their return they could start indigenous industries. India's struggle for independence was being waged both on the political and the economic front. In spite of official apathy, eminent Indians, for instance Jamshedji Tata, realized that India's future progress would depend on industrialization and her ability to acquire scientific knowledge. Jamshedji Tata set up a hydroelectric project to accelerate industrial growth. When he announced his proposal for setting up of a steel mill at Jamshedpur, the arrogant Britishers were shocked. For this was to be the largest integrated steel plant in the British Empire. Tata also provided funds for setting up of the Indian Institute of Science at Bangalore, the first of its kind in Asia. The partition of Bengal, announced in 1905, became an important flashpoint in India's march towards economic and political freedom. The 1906 Calcutta Congress passed a resolution on the boycott of foreign goods and the use of only Swadeshi articles. A mass meeting in the town hall of Calcutta demanded boycott of all types of British goods. The Muslims of Calcutta met at Raja Bazaar to express their support. Students boycotted examinations because they refused to write answers on imported paper. Washermen, cobblers, even barbers refused to serve those who used imported clothes and shoes. Patients declined the use of imported medicine. 50,000 people took a pledge at the Kalighat temple that they would not buy any foreign goods. There were bonfires of coats and trousers, shirts and saris, hats and shoes. The nationalist press propagated the ideals of Swadeshi and boycott. Dada Bhai Nauroji said, Swadeshi is a necessity for India. Gopal Krishna Gokhale said, Swadeshi at its highest is not only an industrial movement, it affects the whole life of the nation. Lala Lajpat Rai said, Swadeshi ought to be the common religion of United India. G. Subramania Iyer described the Swadeshi movement as the only road to national independence. Several Swadeshi enterprises were launched, among them Bengal Chemicals by P.C. Ray and the Punjab National Bank by Lala Lajpat Rai. With Raj Bihari Ghosh as the president, a National Council of Education was established to promote scientific and technical education. Various national educational institutions were established. Bengal National College had Aurobindo Ghosh as its first principal. The Maharashtra Vidyalaya in Pune, the Banaras Hindu University, the Kashi Vidyapeeth, and many more. Chidambaram Pillai founded a weaving factory and a cooperative society in Tuticorin and floated a Swadeshi steam navigation company. By 1911, Jamshedji Tata's dream became a reality. The British Empire's largest steel mill went into production. With the emergence of Gandhi, the Swadeshi movement became a strong platform for the economic and political emancipation of India. He reintroduced the ancient spinning wheel, the charkha, which was to provide sustenance to millions of spinners and weavers. On September the 21st, 1920, at Madurai, Gandhiji gave up the use of upper garments and caps. He started wearing only a loincloth to identify himself with the poverty-stricken masses of India. During 1921, the non-cooperation movement and boycott of foreign goods was intensified. Gandhiji said, "In burning foreign clothes, I burn my shame." Shops selling foreign goods were picketed. The movement for the boycott of foreign goods and the encouragement of Swadeshi had the support of several leading Indian industrialists, such as Ambalal Sarabhai, Anandilal Poddar, Narottam Morarji, Jamnalal Bajaj, G.D. Birla, and others. The Marine National College at Masulipatnam, the Gujarat Vidyapeeth in Ahmedabad, the Jamia Millia Islamia were established. Gandhi described spinning as a gateway to spiritual salvation and set up the All India Spinners Association for the development of khadi. Schools began to give lessons in spinning and weaving. Jawaharlal Nehru called khaddar the livery of our freedom. Eminent leaders such as Motilal Nehru, C.R. Das, C. Rajagopalachari, Abul Kalam Azad, and Vallabhbhai Patel took to wearing only khadi. When the handloom industry was facing a financial crisis in 1925, a national financial institution, the Syndicate Bank, was established at Udipi to help the weavers and spinners. Walchand Hirachand set up industrial units for the manufacture of cement, motor vehicles and ships. Narottam Morarji and Walchand Hirachand launched the Sindhya Steam Navigation Company. Mrs. Sumati Morarji recalled,
"And Sindhya started economic sort of a freedom by starting Sindhya Company. It was on in 5th of April, the first ship sailed. That is how we have Maritime Day, which is celebrated in memory of this Indian shipping, the first Indian ship which sailed from here. That is how we started the movement of Swadeshi. Even shipbuilding, as you know, in Visakhapatnam, we started that. And first ship was launched by Jawaharlal, Jala Usha, which we sent to UK to show the Britishers that India can do it.
The 1931 Karachi Congress passed a resolution which said, political freedom must include real economic freedom of the starving millions. In 1937, the Congress ministers accepted office. They introduced a large number of reforms to help the peasantry and rural industry. Subhash Chandra Bose, the president of the 1938 Congress, and Jawaharlal Nehru were firm believers in planned economic development. An economic planning committee was set up under the chairmanship of Jawaharlal Nehru. Nehru said, India will have to industrialize or submit to foreign economic penetration, which would lead to political interference. During the Second World War, Indian industry took up the challenge and proved that they were as good as the best in the world in the production of highly sophisticated defense requirements. Two years after the end of the war, India became free on the 15th of August 1947. In spite of the tremendous problems created by partition, plans were launched to develop India's economy on scientific lines, to realize the dream of self-reliance and self-sufficiency. Members of the Planning Commission drew their inspiration from the spirit of the freedom movement and the perspective plan prepared by the Congress. A series of five-year plans ushered in an era of intense developmental activity. A strong agricultural, industrial, and scientific base was established. India is now self-sufficient in the production of food and consumer goods. But the economic struggle will continue till we are able to achieve Mahatma Gandhi's dream of wiping every tear from every eye.